When Australia's international border closed, there were fears property prices would collapse, partly because the steady stream of new migrants evaporated, and some experts thought that'd mean demand would plummet. Instead, the cost of homes and apartments in many towns and cities has soared. A federal parliamentary inquiry is now examining ways to tackle housing affordability, and there may be some lessons in the strange economic experiment the pandemic's provided. Here's political reporter Tom Lowrey.
For decades, experts have argued over what makes house prices go up and down. For some, it's as simple as supply and demand. So when the international border closed last year, demand was expected to evaporate as migration, and therefore population growth, ground to a halt. Here's economist Saul Eslake on what happened next.
Well, the people who I used to be one of, that is to say the chief economists of banks, were all forecasting double-digit declines in property prices. Now, quite clearly, none of those dire forecasts came to pass.
Urban planner Professor Nicole Gurran from the University of Sydney says there's a lesson there.
It was a great test case for the thesis that the lack of supply was driving house price inflation in Australia. It clearly wasn't.
Most economists agree that record low interest rates and plenty of federal stimulus have helped keep house prices soaring. But supply is at the centre of a new federal parliamentary inquiry into housing affordability in Australia. By some counts, it's the fifth Commonwealth-led look into the issue in two decades. It's chaired by Liberal MP Jason Falinski.
We do not allow people to build houses where people want to live in them.
Jason Falinski thinks we should be focusing on what he sees as restrictive state and local planning laws.
It's not that we don't have enough land in Australia. It's not that we don't earn enough money because we have some of the highest average weekly earnings in the world. It is because of poor regulations have ensured that people are not allowed to build the homes that they want to live in where they want to live in them.
Professor Gurran says the problem with that argument is that houses only get built when developers can get a good return from them. That is, when prices are rising.
We need to wean the housing industry and housing construction away from house price inflation as a driver for new housing development and for housing construction.
Some argue we're just going to have to live with expensive housing and look for other ways of dealing with it. Here's Brendan Coates from the Grattan Institute.
You're probably going to look at other policies like shared equity schemes, ways of where the government can stand in as the bank of mum and dad for people.
Economist Saul Eslake points over the Tasman for ideas, where negative gearing has been reined in and capital gains tax tweaked to target property investors.
What's remarkable about that is that the sky has not fallen in New Zealand, as is routinely predicted by property-related interests and by the coalition whenever this subject comes up in a conversation on this side of the Tasman.
But he fears politics will be forever stacked against those trying to crack the market.
There are 11 million Australians who own at least one property. Within that, there are at least 2 million who own more than one property. And the last thing those 11 million Australians want any government to do is anything that slows down the rate of growth of property prices.
That's economist Saul Eslake, ending that report from Tom Lowrey.